The question I would address is that extremist groups and movements frequently claim that violence is legitimate in their struggle for their cause. However, most of these movements actually carry out far less violence than they could. And we could then ask, what are the breaks that make them restrain their violence? And how can responses from society serve to reinforce these internal breaks? And knowledge about these processes are obviously relevant for prevention. So this is a topic of a special issue of the online journal Perspectives on Terrorism that will be published in December. And I will share some findings from my own contribution concerning the neo-Nazi Nordic resistance movement. See here. And of special interest here is the relationship between what I call external constraints and internal restraints. Examples of external constraints to the use of terrorist violence may be disruption of plots by security services, incarceration of individual activists, or proscription or banning of the organization, making membership and activities illegal, as happened with the Finnish branch of the Nordic resistance movement. But it might also be backlash from the potential support base, such as loss of support and recruitment. Internal restraints refer to the decisions by the group or activist to abstain from the use of terrorist violence. This might be due to moral objections to certain forms of violence or who are legitimate targets. Another form of external restraint is strategic considerations that terrorist violence might be considered to be counterproductive in the present situation because it is seen as having negative consequences for the group for and their current plans and activities. They might not have any moral objections to large-scale violence, but put it on hold until the conditions are more beneficial to achieve their political goals, such as carrying out successful revolution. External constraints may also become internalized in the sense that the expectation of negative sanctions makes the group or activities decide to restrain its violence. This is what is otherwise known as deterrence. Deterrence does not work on all extremist groups, but it clearly has an impact on some. And the Nordic resistance movement is one case where deterrence actually seem to work. The Nordic resistance movement is a national socialist organization with branches in Sweden, Norway, Finland, Denmark, and also a small one in Iceland. Its declared goal is to establish a pan-Nordic white state. It's hierarchical and a fairly disciplined organization. And in its official handbooks for activists, the NRM states clearly that quote, the resistant movement is not pacifist. We are aware that we can only be victorious through physical struggle. In the future, our weapons will be decisive on the battlefield, but at present, as long as we can act legally, there is no reason for the resistance movement to arm itself with guns and explosives. And the handbook also states that activists who carry out acts of violence that are not approved by the organization will be excluded. In reality, however, the organization does not seem to enforce this strictly, sometimes even honoring rather than punishing members who overstep the boundaries on violence officially drawn by the leadership. The NRM is definitely a militant organization. Many of the core activists have a criminal record characterized by severe violence and in some cases homicide. Activists train in street fighting and knife combat. Many activists have acquired guns legally or illegally as preparation for a future racial war. And some forms of violence is permitted or even desirable. And they seek out actively situations to provoke and test boundaries. But despite its capacity and readiness for violence, the Nordic resistance movement has nevertheless shown restraint in its actual use of violence, often balancing on the border of illegality. Terrorism is not part of the NRM's action repertoire in the present situation, but it does not preclude the use of terrorist violence in the future. The NRM leaders' views on the mass shooting of Muslims in New Zealand in March 2019 is quite revealing. He expressed sympathy with the mass murderer Brenton Tarrant and the motives expressed in his manifesto. In the context of a war to defend the white race, such mass violence is justified, he claimed. And he also said that the perpetrator, quote, seems to have chosen his targets carefully to avoid hitting those that are completely innocent. I mean, who is innocent? He killed 51 Muslim men, women, and even children. However, the NRM leader also claimed that although such attacks are legitimate, they do not, quote, improve the situation of white people in neither New Zealand nor the world, at least not in the current situations. And such methods might be counterproductive because they lead to increased repression, or at least they may lead to that. It may lead to increase of sympathy for the enemies and undermine the legal activities the NRM has now some success with. The NRM leaders and activists are very much aware of the legal boundaries set by the government and tune many of their actions as close to the limit of illegality as possible. For example, the NRM regularly engaged in street fighting with the police and political enemies on the left, thereby pushing the limits and testing the police response. They also make subtle death threats against political opponents, often usually sufficiently vague to avoid criminal prosecution. The NRM tries to balance the internal fostering of a militant identity as a revolutionary combat organization with a more moderate image for external consumption of being an organization that acts civilly and legally. For example, it takes part in political elections and so on. And they want to benefit from the opportunities provided by the democratic system they despise. This balancing act is risky. If the organization appears too timid, it risks internal rebellion from militants lusting for action. And that was what happened with this group in Gothenburg, who were very frustrated about the reluctance of the leadership to use violence and terrorism. But if it goes too far in promoting or accepting violence, the organization may also risk to be banned or at least lose access to many public arenas and opportunities. And we've seen examples of both outcomes. As mentioned, in 2017, militant activists in Gothenburg left the NRM and carried out bombing attacks on their own in frustration and defiance of the NRM leader's ban on terrorist violence. And police had wiretaps where they could listen in on some of their conversation, and they were really frustrated about how soft the leadership was. And after the attacks, the NRM stated that they were not behind the attacks, but they also refused to condemn the perpetrators, which is also a policy of the organization. They will not condemn those who do things on their own. On the other hand, we had this attack in 2016, where an activist at an NRM stand in Helsinki, Finland, kicked down a person who had mocked them when he passed by. The victim died a week later due to complications of head injuries. And the perpetrator was convicted for racially aggravated assault, but cleared of manslaughter. However, he was awarded a distinction by the Nordic resistance movement, quote, for his courage and his loyalty to the organization and his comrades. However, this kind of distinction and award led to the proscription of the Nordic resistance movement in Finland with severe consequences of it for its activities. And I'm sure Tommi Kotonen will tell you more about that. This balancing act between militancy and underground activities on the one hand and open legal activities such as mass demonstrations and contending elections on the other led to the internal tension and split of the NRM in mid-2019. Many core activists joined the breakaway group called the Nordic Force, and clearly the split has left both factions weakened. The NRM leadership is certainly not opposed to large-scale violence and terrorism in principle. External factors and strategic considerations put a limit on their use of violence for now. However, they state quite openly that this might be reconsidered if the contextual situation changes, for example, if the organization is banned and opportunities to act legally are closed. Political opponents or other so-called traitors to the people, as well as racial minorities, would then be considered legitimate targets of violence. Such statements of conditional restraint might be considered as a kind of veiled threat from the NRM directed at the Nordic governments. If you ban us, we will turn to terrorism. However, such a ban against the Finnish branch of the NRM has already been implemented and a terrorist response has not yet materialized. However, the warning about a possible turn to terrorism, whether that is empty words, that remains to be seen. But the proscription of the Finnish branch proved that the threat of banning is real. And I think that was a lesson learned by the Nordic resistance movement. A relevant question is whether the Nordic resistance movement should be considered as a barrier or as a conveyor belt to terrorism. Up until now, the NRM has probably served more as a barrier to terrorist violence by reining in its more violence-prone activists. Allowing extremist groups some open avenues for legal activities may make them opt for this alternative rather than for a more violent strategy. On the other hand, the NRM does prepare its members for a large-scale violence in what they consider to be an inevitable racial war in the future. Maintaining the NRM's boundaries against excessive violence is obviously not only a task for the NRM leadership, but it's even more so for governmental authorities, the police, the security services, and the courts. The efforts of the NRM to test and expand the boundaries on violence should be pushed firmly back by enforcing the rule of law. Equally important, intimidating politicians and others into silence, even if it's done by subtle threats, is challenging democracy just as much as actual violence is. The police and lawmakers should draw and maintain clear boundaries against such attacks on democracy. A final point, external constraints such as the threat of criminal prosecution or proscription of extremist organization is sometimes more effective if it remains a credible threat, reinforcing internal restraints and breaks against violence. Yeah, I will stop here.